الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا اما بعد فاعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم واذا قيل لهم امنوا كما امن الناس قالوا ونؤمن كما امن السفهاء الا انهم هم السفهاء ولكن لا يعلمون صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين Brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Last week, we had been speaking about Hazrat Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Like I told you that we're going to do a long, lengthy course on Hazrat Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And I wanted to cover Hazrat Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu from every single direction. Because the more angles and the more directions you look at an individual, that is when you understand that person's esteem. That is when you understand that person's rank. That is when you understand that what regards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and this religion has and what regards we are supposed to have for that individual. So it's very important that rather than having, you know, a narrow sight, it's better to have a wide, broad sight looking at an individual from which you can understand that person a lot more, a lot better, a lot deeper. So last week we talked about his father. Today, inshallah, we're going to be speaking about his mother, whose name was Hazrat Hind binti Utba radiallahu ta'ala anha. But just before I go on to her, last week I mentioned something which I just want to elaborate on a bit because it's very, very important. I mentioned, if you can remember, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made a peace treaty with the Christians of Najran. It was a place called Najran, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made a peace treaty with them. And I mentioned there two points. Point number one, I mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the peace treaty was made, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made five people sign that peace treaty from his own self and from his own side. And one of those individuals was none other than Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And I drew your attention towards the fact that you would only put a person who is reliable, his signature, on a peace treaty. If you didn't have reliance upon that person, if you didn't have trust in that person, you would never get that person to sign. That's number one. Number two, after the peace treaty was made, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I mentioned to you that he made Hazrat Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu the governor of Najran and that area. Now our opponents who abuse Hazrat Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu, one of the objections that they raise on Abu Sufyan is that no, he was never ever made the governor of Najran. That is an absolute lie. And what they will say to you is they mention another Sahabi's name and they say that he was made the governor of Najran. That is a misunderstanding because of either ignorance or because of hatred that they have towards Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Let me tell you the reality of the matter. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made Abu Sufyan and the other Sahabi governor, he gave both of them two separate jobs. He gave them both separate jobs. The first Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his job was only to lead the salah. I just want you just to understand this fact. That Sahabi was told by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to lead the salah. That's number one. And number two is, Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was the individual who everybody would come and they would gather their zakat and sadaqat with him. Which also makes him a part, if not the only governor, it makes him a part of the governing body, which was the two people. So he is just as good as a governor as the other Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anhu. You can't dismiss him and say he wasn't a governor and only he was a governor. Rather, the main job and where the most trust was needed and required, that was where all the sadaqah and all the zakat and all the wealth of the people was. And that was Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu was made in charge of that, which shows the reliability Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had upon him. So that was a very, very important point that I had to make and that I had to clear, that if you ever come across that situation where somebody puts this in front of you and says that this is a lie, then you can clarify for that person, or you might think that you might read it somewhere else. The clarity of the matter is that one was Imam of the place and one was the person who was collecting all the sadaqah and all the zakat. So basically you can imagine it as a governing body, and he was part, or he was half of the governing body. Moving on to his mother. Now, remembering that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, just as he had male companions, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam also had female companions. And what I mean by female companions is females who had embraced Islam upon the hands of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And many of them played an active role. Many of them played an active role in spreading the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and helping Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and helping Sahaba ikiram radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een. And the first one who I want to mention is none other than the Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. You know, how can we forget Hazrat Khadija? She, when nobody was there, she was consoling and comforting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So nobody denies, you know, the services to this deen that were given by Hazrat Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. After that, you have none other than Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, the daughter of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. You have Hazrat Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha, who is the daughter of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. You had Asma binti Yazid radiallahu ta'ala anha. You had Ummi Haram radiallahu ta'ala binti Mil'an radiallahu ta'ala anha. You had all these different women who had played a massive role in helping Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions in spreading the deen and making the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mazboot and firm in Makkah al-Mukarramah, similarly in Madinah al-Munawwara. And they helped, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they helped this deen here to get to Bradford down here. So they have an active role they played. Therefore, it is compulsory that we hold respect for them like we hold respect for the males, and we look up to them like we look up to the other Sahaba radiallahu anhum. And one of these females was none other than the mother of Hazrat Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and the wife of Hazrat Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Now Hazrat Abu Sufyan had a number of wives. He had a number of wives, and one of the wives was this one that we're talking about today, the mother of Hazrat Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anha. Her name was Hind binti Utbah radiallahu ta'ala anha. Now when did she embrace Islam? She embraced Islam only one day after Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu embraced Islam, and that was in the eighth year of Hijrah migration. Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu embraced Islam only a short while later, probably a day later. He must have encouraged her, shown her all the signs of Islam. Okay, look, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving victory. These were people who we expelled from Makkah al-Mukarramah. Now look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them izzat and ihtiram, and Allah has given the whole holy land, Allah has given it to them. Obviously, seeing this, she had embraced Islam. But there's one or two things that behind the scenes, not many ulama have actually mentioned this. Not many ulama have actually mentioned it, but behind the scenes, there were a few things that actually impacted her, which shows her sincerity in deen and Islam. Hazrat Muawiyah narrates from his mother, Hazrat Hind radiallahu ta'ala. He says that one day my mother, she was telling me that after Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they went back to Madinah al-Munawwara after the Battle of Uhud, and all the Kufar and Mushrikeen, they came back to Makkah al-Mukarramah. She says that I also came back. And when I had come back, she said that the first night after I came back, I saw a dream in which I saw that the whole world has just become pitch dark. The whole world has become pitch dark. All the sky is dark, the land, the mountains, everything, the whole land, everything has become dark. And she says, I can't see anything, and I'm looking about, but there's nothing in sight. And then all of a sudden, she says, a small light appears, and gradually it gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And all of a sudden, the whole sky, the mountains, the land, the deserts, everything become illuminated. And she says that I see that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he comes in front of me and he invites me to Islam. This was on the first night. Then she says that the second night, again, she goes to sleep and she sees that the idol that she used to worship was called Hubul and Hafsa. So she says that I saw, I saw Hubul, and I am on like Pul Sirat, and he's on my right hand side, and I can see that this other idol that I worship is on my left hand side, and that idol is also calling me, and I'm thinking that if I answer the call, I'm going to fall into the fire of Jahannam. And then I'm looking on the left and the other idols I've been worshipping, that's also calling me. And I'm thinking that if I call out to the Allah, if I reach out, I'm going to fall into the fire of Jahannam. And then all of a sudden I see that Rasulullah, he's standing in front of me, and the Prophet Allah, he's calling me, and I've straight away I've understood that this is his invitation. Lo and behold, next day, third night, she sees that she's again on the end, right on the edge of Jahannam, and she's about to fall in. And the idol that she used to worship, Hubal, he's telling her, go in, drop in, fall in, fall in. And she's thinking to herself, no, I don't want to fall in. You know how sometimes you're falling in a dream and you're thinking, no, I want to save myself. She's like that. And she said, then all of a sudden, the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he grabs hold of her from behind and he pulls her back. When he pulls her back, she said, I woke up and I realized that this is definitely guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah wants to guide me. Now, only Allah knows, she must have hid this inside her heart and never told anyone, because you have to remember, her and her husband, both prior to Islam, were staunch enemies of Islam, Rasulullah and Sahaba radiallahu anhu. And, you know, being honest, yes, they caused a lot of inconvenience to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that can't be denied. Like many other Sahaba radiallahu anhu, Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu ta'ala, look, he was safe from suyufillah. He was a sword from amongst the swords of Allah. But look, he caused much nuksan and inconvenience to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The whole of the Battle of Uhud, if you want to say that whatever happened between Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was hurt, so many Sahaba were martyred, so many women became widowed, so many children were made orphan. And who was it all because of? Khalid ibn Walid. He was on the side of the Kufar at that time. Yet when he embraced Islam, Rasulullah sallallahu called him Saifu min Suyufillah. So just because those Sahaba radiallahu anhum who later became Muslim, we are not supposed to look at what they did prior to Islam, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven everything, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned it inside the Quran that وَإِن كَانُوا مِن قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Allah says it himself. Allah is the Lord. Allah is the one who's created us. Allah is the one who's going to put in Jahannam and Jannat. He's the one that does everything. It is his religion, it is his Nabi, they're his Sahaba, they're his people, they're his land. Everything belongs to him. Allah is saying, وَإِن كَانُوا مِن قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ, that these Sahaba, even though, yes, they were in open deviance before, مِن قَبْلُ, but that was before, Allah says. That was before, not after. After, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cleansed their heart through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, she says that she woke up, and the idol that she used to worship, she goes up to this idol, and she smashed the idol to pieces. She smashed the idol, but yet she still hasn't embraced Islam. Many years later, like I said, this is one of the things that probably impacted her at that time, remembering all these dreams. And that is when, on the conquest of Makkah al-Mukarramah, when she got a bit of encouragement from her husband, and already seen that her two sons, Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala and Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala, both have embraced Islam. It was an al-Nujj, and alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she embraced Islam. Similarly, once there was another very nice incident mentioned in the books. This incident that I've just mentioned here about this dream, this can be found in the Musnad of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and also in Tariq ibn Asakir, this incident I've just mentioned. Moving on, Ibn Asakir rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions another very nice incident. He says that one day, Hazrat Hind radiallahu ta'ala anha, she got a leather bag and put some drink inside a leather bag, some milk or some sweet drink. What they would do in them days is they would get dates and put it inside water, leave it overnight, and that would make a sweet drink called Nabiz. And then they would send that to the Prophet ﷺ, or sometimes, you know, they would cool it down and they would drink it themselves. So she sent some sweet drink in a leather bag and some roasted meat to the Prophet ﷺ with a slave girl. This slave girl came to the Prophet ﷺ, and Rasulullah ﷺ, he was with his wives in a valley called Abtah at that time when this slave girl came. He was with some of his wives. They were sitting inside a tent, and this slave girl, she came and presented this gift that was sent to the Prophet ﷺ from Hazrat Hind radiallahu ta'ala anha. Rasulullah accepted the gift. After accepting the gift, this slave girl gave a message to the Prophet. She said that this present has been given by Hazrat Hind radiallahu ta'ala anha, And she is asking that you make dua for her. Because this year, her goats, the milk, there's no barakah inside the milk. And also, you know, their offspring, there's not much barakah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made dua for Hazrat Hind. And he said that, oh Allah, put barakah inside the milk of her goats. And oh Allah, put barakah inside the offspring of those goats. This slave girl and Hazrat Hind radiallahu ta'ala, she says that such barakah came in the next in the coming years. Such barakah we experience in the milk, and not only in the milk, but in the offspring of the goats that we had never, ever, ever seen. And then she mentions another dream. And she says that one day again, I was asleep and I saw a dream in which I was inside the desert and it was extremely hot. And I couldn't find any shade, and I was running about and walking about searching for some shade, and I was very, very thirsty. And she said that all of a sudden I saw Rasulullah, he came and he took hold of my hand inside the dream, and he took me towards some shade. All of a sudden some shade appeared and I sat in the shade, and that's when I got some rest. And then look, she interprets the dream herself. She says, Subhanallah, this was him taking me away from the heat of kufr and disbelief into the coolness and the shade of Islam. This was her own interpretation. She says that he took me away from the heat of the kufr into the shade and the coolness of Islam. And she says, Subhanallah, if it wasn't for him, then we would have never, ever, ever achieved these things. You can see her piety and her sincerity and her love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and for deen. Now to call these people, and this incident that I've just mentioned, this is in Tariq Dimashq and Ibn Asakir. We can see, look, calling these people kafir, taking reliance of these people, where does that leave Islam? Where does that leave deen? Because what you have to understand is these people are the narrators. Inshallah, like inshallah, coming up, I'll be showing you that she was also a narrator of hadith. Now, Sahaba Kiram, they are the narrators of this deen. If we call them kafir, or we take reliance upon them, or we say that they weren't trustworthy, then every single part of deen becomes doubtful. Let me just give you one quick example and then we'll move on. Hazrat Maulana Abdul Shakur Lakhnavi rahmatullahi alayhi, who is known as the Imam of Ahl Sunnah, he one day had a discussion with some of our opponents, some of the adversaries of Sahaba radiallahu anhu. He had a bit of a discussion with them, and he said to them that I want to put one point forward in front of you. You people say that leave Sahaba. Let's leave the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, and let's only take our religion from the Ahli Bayt Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. Have you understood that? This is their stance. They say, let's leave the Sahaba. You are allowed to take your religion from Sahaba. You can only take it from who? The Ahli Bayt. According to them, who is the Ahli Bayt? The Ahli Bayt are Ali bin Abi Talib, Hazrat Fatima, Hassan and Hussein, four people. They are the Ahli Bayt according to them. Now he says, that look, according to you, all Sahaba radiallahu anhum became kafir. If all Sahaba became kafir, that means that there is, after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, during the era of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and after he passed away, you'll only get a few groups of people. Number one, you're going to get the Jews, yes or no? They were there present at the time, and after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, that's one group. The second group was the Christians. The third group was the Mushrikeen. Three groups after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. The fourth group was who? Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Okay? There was Sahaba radiallahu anhum, because remember one thing, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi, he has mentioned this hadith, that after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, hypocrisy ended. Those people who were hypocrites in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were only hypocrites. Why? Because they were hiding from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is gone, they became open kafir. There was a few of them, they became open kafir. So number one, you got the Jews, you've got the Christians, you've got the polytheists, the mushrikeen. And then you've got Sahaba radiallahu anhu. The only last group you've got left now is who? The Ahli Bayt, those four people that I've just mentioned to you. If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has gone from this dunya, we have this Quran that is with us. And this Quran could have only come to us through these five groups. Either you're going to have to accept that it came through the Jews to you. Would you accept the Quran? Would you accept the Quran? No. Or either it came from the Christians, a Quran from the Christians, mashallah, they can't take care of their own Bible. Would you accept the Quran? No. The third group was the mushrikeen, the polytheists. Either they've given you the Quran, would you accept the Quran? No, you wouldn't. The fourth group that was there was Sahaba radiallahu anhum and the Ahli Bayt. Now the Quran could have only possibly come now to you from these two groups. Either it's come from the Sahaba or either it's come from the Ahli Bayt ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. But according to our opponents, Sahaba all became kafir. So if they've all become kafir, astaghfirullah, should you take the Quran from them? Should you take the Quran from them if they've become kafir? No. How can you take the Quran from them? Last group left, the Ahli Bayt. Now, according to our opponents, they were Muslim. But guess what? According to even our opponents, the Ahli Bayt have a masla in their religion. And that is nine-tenths of their religion is that you're supposed to be hiding your religion. 90% of the Aqeedah of the Ahli Bayt is that you're supposed to hide the religion. Balki, those that came after, they used to say that if you expose this religion and open up this religion, then the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will become upon you. Now you tell me, this Quran, how can it ever be trusted? If you call Sahaba kafir, you could have taken it off the first group, you can't take it off the second group, you can't take it off the third group, and for our opponents, you can't even take it from the fourth group because you believe them to be kafir. So how can you take it from the fifth group whose religion is that 90% of the religion is that you're supposed to be hiding it? Do you understand my point? How can you take a Quran from a bunch of people who believe and 90% of their belief is that you're supposed to be hiding the religion? If you're supposed to be hiding the religion and you're taking the Quran of them, now that makes that Quran doubtful, because 90% of their religion is they're supposed to be hiding the religion. If they're supposed to be hiding the religion, that means that Quran that you've got is a dodgy Quran. Astaghfirullah, na'udhu billahi min zalik. This is why, what do we say? We say, no. Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, Fatima and Hassan and Hussein never ever had such beliefs, number one. And second of all, making them separate, casting them as a separate group, Ahli Bayt, and casting the Sahaba as a separate group, this is an agenda of those who are an enemy of Islam. We say Sahaba, and what do we include? We include the family of Rasulullah, and we include all the companions of Rasulullah. When we say that one word, we don't separate anybody. We say they were all Sahaba, they were all companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Huh? Some were family, some were wives, some were like this, some were friends, some were better friends, some were further friends, some were closer friends. But there's one name for every single one of them, and that is Sahaba radiallahu anhum. And this Quran, we have taken it from them. This is why it is very, very important that the reliability of Sahaba radiallahu anhum we keep inside our hearts. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has left us with so much to show us that these individuals are reliable and they are trustworthy, and whatever they give you, take it from them. Is that understood? So we can see that from the story. Anyway, the Pledge of Allegiance. Allah subhanahu, some of the women of Quraysh and some of the women that had embraced Islam from other tribes, after the conquest of Makkah al-Mukarramah, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to attain the honor of the Pledge of Allegiance, taking bay'at with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And why did they do this? They did this to attain the sawab of the ayat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, إِذَا جَاءَكَ الْمُؤْمِنَاتُ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ إِذَا جَاءَكَ الْمُؤْمِنَاتُ يُبَايِعْنَكَ عَلَىٰ أَلَّا يُشْرِكْنَ بِاللَّهِ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَسْرِقْنَ وَلَا يَزْنِينَ وَلَا يَقْتُلْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ وَلَا يَأْتِينَ بِبُهْتَانٍ يَفْتَرِينَهُ بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِنَّ وَأَرْجُلِهِنَّ وَلَا يَعْصِينَكَ فِي مَعْرُوفٍ فَبَايِعْهُنَّ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُنَّ اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Now, in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that when these women come to you, then you have to take bay'at from them. So Hazrat Hind radiallahu ta'ala, she was also one of those women that came with all the other women to, you know, achieve this blessing of pledging allegiance upon the hands of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When she came, It's mentioned in Tabaqat ibn Sa'd that she was very, very nervous because of her hostilities towards Islam and the Muslims before that, previously, and naturally anybody would be, you know, very, very nervous. She came and she had a niqab on and she sat in the presence of Rasulullah thinking that he won't recognize me. But after a short while, she introduced herself and she gave a salam to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to her, marhaban bik, that, you know, basically, welcome. Marhaban bik, welcome. Now, this was a welcome from who? Not from me and you, and not from anybody else. This was a welcome from who? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we say that that is one belonging to her repertoire of belongings, her virtues, that she was welcomed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That was number one. Al-Bahru al-Muhit is a tafsir, and in there is a narration that when she came, she sat down, and like I said, she was very nervous. She said to the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that, oh Prophet of Allah, look, she had read Quran before. She had read Quran before, and she had read about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam inside the Quran. In 26 sifara, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, inna fatahna laka fatham mubina liyaghfira laka Allahu ma taqaddama min dhanbik. That Allah has given, we have given you clear victory. Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina. We've given you clear victory, and we're going to forgive all your sins that have passed. As in, what do you call it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you are totally forgiven, you are pure from sin. It's just a way of saying, you know, I've forgiven your sin. That didn't mean that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had sin. That meant that, you know, everything is gone, you're absolutely pure, there's nothing wrong with you, absolutely infallible. So she came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and she said, Ya Rasulullah, Allah has forgiven all your sins. If Allah has forgiven all your sins, then why don't you forgive all our sins? Why don't you forgive all our sins? Look how she presented it. You know, ulama, they say she was very, very hushyar. And I'm going to show you a conversation that she had with the Prophet ﷺ from where you understand. You know, some women are very, very dazed in it. Yeah, she was very, very dazed, very witty. Yeah, being Abu Sufyan's wife, she had to be very, very witty. And she was a leader of so many women. So, and, you know, ulama who have written regarding her, they say that she was a woman with excellent opinion. People would come to her, women would come to her and ask her opinion. You know, sometimes you might go to Maulana or Fulan here and there, and sometimes people give you a crap opinion, and sometimes people give you a very, very good opinion, and that's because of, you know, their experience and, you know, their wisdom. They'll give you very, very good mashura and consultation. So women would come to her, so she was very, very jalak and very, very, you know, witty and very, very wise. So she came to the Prophet ﷺ and look how she presented her case. Allah has forgiven you, why don't you forgive us? Rasulullah ﷺ said, I've forgiven everything. And not only that, ulama write that Rasulullah ﷺ welcomed her. He forgave everything that she did and extended his kindness to her and even respected her and gave her honor. You've got honor and dignity from Rasulullah ﷺ. What more do you want? Anyway, Imam Bukhari rahmatullah, he mentions a very, very beautiful narration. Imam Bukhari mentions this, and Imam Muslim mentions this, and Ibn Kathir rahmatullah, he also mentions this in his Al-Bidayah wa Nihayah. He says that one day she came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, O Prophet of Allah, there was nobody who was more hated and despised than you and your family in the times of ignorance. But now that I have embraced Islam, there is nobody who is more beloved, and there's no household or family more beloved to me on the face of this than your family and your household. Rasulullah, he took a qasam and he confirmed her love. He said, I swear by Allah this is true. I swear by Allah this is true. And then look at the words the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, now Allah will only increase you in this. Imam Nawawi and other ulama, they have written, what did the Prophet ﷺ mean in increasing? As in, he is going to increase. Now you're not going to go back towards hatred and kufr. This was an indirect testimony from Rasulullah ﷺ that you are going to remain upon hidayat. You are going to remain upon hidayat. And like I told you the other day, يا أيها الذين آمنوا من يرتد منكم عن دينه فسوف يأتي الله بقوم يحبهم ويحبونه أذلة على المؤمنين أعزة على الكافرين يجاهدون في سبيل الله. That when those people who are going to become murtad, After the Prophet ﷺ goes, Allah is going to bring those yuhibbuhum wa yuhibbunahu. He loves them and they love him. As in the ushaq, the lovers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And look what Rasulullah ﷺ is saying in this hadith too. So how can you say that she's going to turn away from Islam when Allah is saying that the ones I am going to bring to fight the ones that are going to turn away from Islam are the ones who are going to have love in their hearts for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here, you know, the Sufiya, they just mentioned a very, very nice point. I'll just quickly mention it here. If you look, they say that in this verse, what does Allah say? Allah says, who is he going to bring? The ones he loves and the ones that love him. Allah mentions his love first, then their love. Allah mentioned his love first, that he loves them and they love him. And they say, why does Allah mention that? The reason why is because if a person has love in his heart for Allah, you should know that before you had that love, Allah had love for you. Before you had that love inside your heart for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah had that love for you before you had that love. This is why he granted you that love. This is why he granted you that love. So what was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what's that showing down here? That number one, she is going to be amongst those people who are going to come against the disbelievers and the apostates, because she has got love and Rasulullah has guaranteed her that this love is only going to increase. So he's giving her an indirect, okay, don't worry about it. Now there's no chance that you're going to go backwards. It's only going to be going forwards. You're only going to go forward and you're only going to increase in this love. And I mentioned even in the Ramadan Durus that that person who has love for Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inshallah, he is protected from apostasy. Because love is blind. Nothing can come and take over your mind once you have got love for Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Moving on, a conversation with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In this verse, they, which all the women came to act upon, what does Allah say? Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nabi, idha ja'akal mu'minatu yubayi'anaka ala alla yushrikana billahi shay'an. Number one, that when you pledge allegiance, when they pledge allegiance, they have to pledge allegiance and a few conditions. Number one, they are not going to associate any partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alla yushrikana billahi shay'an. Wala yasrikana, not going to steal. Wala yazmina, they're not going to fornicate or adultery. وَلَا يَسْرِنَا وَلَا يَسْرِنَا وَلَا يَقْتُلْنَا أَوْلَادَهُنَا. And they're not going to kill their children. Because that's what they used to do in the days of ignorance. They would bury their daughters alive or they would kill their children because of fear of, you know, them taking sustenance, etc. And then, you know, the parents will have enough. So in fear of that, what did they used to do? They used to just kill the child. So you're not going to kill the children. وَلَا يَقْتُلْنَا أَوْلَادَهُنَا. وَلَا يَأْتِينَ بِبُهْتَانِ يَفْتَرِينَهُ بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِنَّ وَأَرْجُلِهِنَّ وَلَا يَعْصِينَكَ فِي مَعْرُوفٍ. And you're not going to slander people. You're not going to backbite people. You're not going to slander people. And you're going to do all the good. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says to her that, right, all the women, you have to exclaim after me that you are not going to do shirk. So like I said, she was very, very witty. She said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, How do we expect you to tolerate from us what you would not tolerate from the men? As in, you would not tolerate polytheism and worshipping idols from the men. How do you expect it? How do you think that we would expect you to tolerate that from us? Of course, we're not going to do shirk. Then the Prophet ﷺ said that now you have to take a pledge that you are never ever going to steal. So she came and she whispered. Remember, there was a parda between her and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So she came and whispered to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that, Ya Rasulullah, you know, Abu Sufyan, my husband, is a bit tight. And he only gives us a bit of money, which is not even sufficient for us. So what I do is I go to his pocket and I take what is sufficient for me and my children and I spend it. And is that all right? And she didn't know that Abu Sufyan sitting right next to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So look, this is how you, subhanallah, this is how you keep somebody's parda. So he whispered to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, Ya Rasulullah, tell her, I've forgiven her for what she's taken. And even in future, whatever she takes, I'll forgive her. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave her permission that, okay, you can take what is only sufficient, and this permission is only for you, for no other woman. ولا يسرقنا ولا يزمينا. Listen to this very carefully. And you're not going to fornicate or commit adultery. She was absolutely shocked. She said, Ya Rasulullah, why are you taking such a pledge from us? Can an honorable woman ever commit zina? Can an honorable woman ever commit zina? We never did this in the jahiliyyah. Do you really think that we are, after embracing Islam, we are going to do this? So the Prophet ﷺ said, pledge taken, pledge taken. Then he said to her, وَلَا يَخْتُلْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ, that you are not going to kill your children. She said, Ya Rasulullah, رَبِينَاهُمْ سِغَارًا وَقَتَلْتَهُمْ كِبَارًا. She said, O Prophet of Allah, we nurtured them when they were young, but in the battle of Uhud and Badr, you're the one that killed them. Her son, Hazrat Hanzala, was killed in the battle of Uhud. In the battle of Badr or in the battle of Uhud. So she said, O Prophet of Allah, رَبِينَاهُمْ سِغَارًا, we nurtured them when we brought them up. وَقَتَلْتَهُمْ سِغَارًا, and you are the ones that killed them. As in, what she's trying to, she's not being disrespectful. What she's trying to say is, there's no chance of that even happening because you've already taken them. There's no chance of that happening because they're all gone anyway. So that can't happen. We're not going to do shirk because we've come here for tawheed. We're not going to steal. We're not going to commit zina because we never committed zina in the days of ignorance. Why are we going to commit in the days of Islam? And when it comes to the children, forget us, Lord. We're the ones that raised them. You're the ones that killed them for us. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that, look, you're not going to slander. We're not going to slander, O Prophet of Allah. And you are not going to and you will bring all وَلَا يَعْتِينَ بِبُهْتَانِ يَفْتَرِينَهُمْ بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِنَّ وَرْجُلِهِنَّ وَلَا يَعْصِينَكَ فِي مَعْرُوفٍ, and you will not commit any other guna. And this is, she accepted it. And then what, look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. Allah says, now you have to do istighfar from them. O Prophet of Allah, now you have to do istighfar for them. So I want to ask you one thing. This point has just freshly come down. Taza. Look at this, subhanAllah. This is an ajeeb thing. She's having this beautiful conversation. And you know, this conversation can be fully found in the books of our opponents. This isn't only in our books. This is in the books of also our opponents. You can find it in many of their books. And this conversation with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, after this conversation, what did Allah say? Allah said, فَبَايِعُنَّ, take their pledge, O Prophet Allah. Take the pledge. وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُنَّ, and now you have to do tawbah for them. You have to do istighfar for them. If she was a munafiq, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't allowed to do tawbah and istighfar for munafiqeen. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't allowed to do istighfar for munafiqeen. Allah says, "Istaghfir lahum, aw la tastaghfir lahum. In tastaghfir lahum 70 marratan, falan yaghfir Allahu lahum." O Prophet of Allah, whether you do istighfar for them or whether you don't do istighfar for them, and even if you do istighfar for them 70 times, Allah will never ever accept your istighfar for them. So then, why is Allah telling him to do istighfar for them? And she's the main one out of all of them. That clearly shows that she had solid iman. And anybody who is calling her a kafir needs to wait till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes them to task. Calling sahaba radiallahu anhum kafir, wallahi al-azim, Allah will take you to task. Not only on the day of qiyamah, Allah will take you to task even in this dunya. Calling sahaba kafir, look at those who only hurt Hazrat Usman radiallahu ta'ala. Those who hurt Hazrat Usman, if you look in the books of history, what happened to them and how their final moments were, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished those who killed and murdered Hazrat Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Karbala. Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dealt with those. There's many different stories. I don't want to go into them. So this was a major waqia regarding her and her bay'at with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you can see that she acquired the blessings of istighfar from who? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Her participation in Yarmouk, very, very important. I mentioned this last week, that her husband, Abu Sufyan, her son, Yazid ibn Sufyan, her other son, Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, herself, her daughter, Hadrat Juwayriya binti Abi Sufyan, and her son-in-law, Juwayriya radiallahu ta'ala anhu, has her husband, all six of them, they participated and they threw themselves in the battlefield. And the ulama, they write, the Hazrat Hind radiallahu ta'ala anha, what was she doing? This is what she was saying. Every time she saw the mujahideen from among Sahaba radiallahu anhum, in trouble or in some difficult circumstance, she would say to them, عَدُّوا الْغِلْفَانَ بِسُّيُّفِكُمْ عَدُّوا الْغِلْفَانَ بِسُّيُّفِكُمْ O Sahaba, O Mujahideen, go and shred these uncircumcised men with your swords. Go and shred these uncircumcised men with your swords. So if she was a munafiqah, astaghfirullah, or she was insincere, would she be standing there and saying that? La hawla wa la quwwata. She was inciting and spurring Sahaba radiallahu anhum and Mujahideen who were fighting in the battle of Yarmouk onto this. Now, she might only be doing this, but remember, for jihad in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are many, many, many different sawabs. Many, many different sawabs because of which she acquired every single one of them. One or two, a few hadiths, let me read out to you. Imam al-Tirmizi, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Bayhaqi, and Imam Haqib, rahimahumullah ta'ala, all muhaddisin, they say, that Allah, Ughzu fi sabilillah, go and do jihad in the path of Allah. Man qatala fi sabilillah fuwaqa naqatin. Whoever does jihad in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fuwaqa naqatin, equivalent to the time it takes to milk one camel. How long does it take to milk a camel? 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes? If you do jihad, man qatala fi sabilillah fuwaqa naqatin wajabat lahu al-jannah. Jannat is wajib, compulsory upon the individual. For how long? Not for one day, not for half an hour, not for 3 hours, not for 2 hours. No. Fuwaqa naqa. The time equivalent it takes to milk a goat or an animal or a cow or something like that. If you spend that much time, she spent, Allahu alam, how many days it must have been. In another hadith, which is mentioned by Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi, inna fil jannati mi'ata darja, that there are 100 ranks in Jannatul Firdaus. There are 100 ranks. A'addaha Allahu lil mujahideen fi sabilillah ma bayna darajatayn kama bayna as-sama'i wal ard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Rasulullah s.a.w. says in a hadith of Bukhari, there are 100 ranks in Jannatul Firdaus for who Allah has prepared them himself. Allah has prepared them himself for mujahideen in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And each of the distance between two ranks, the distance between two ranks is the distance between the heaven and the earth. This is what she earned herself in where? In the battle of Yarmouk. This is what she had put inside her bag of deeds inside Yarmouk. Who is anybody in this day and age walking up and down these streets down here to call people like that kafir? In another hadith, Rasulullah s.a.w. he says, مَغْبَرَّتْ قَدَمَا عَبْدٍ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ فَتَمَسَّهُ النَّارِ. Imam Bukhari narrates this hadith. He says that if the feet of an individual become dusty in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the fire of Jahannam will never ever touch those feet. The fire of Jahannam will never ever touch those feet. And in another hadith that's narrated by Imam Tirmizi rahmatullah alayhi, Rasulullah s.a.w. he says, وَلَا يَجْتَمِعُ عَلَى عَبْدٍ غُبَارٌ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَدُخَانُ جَهَنَّمُ. That the smoke of Jahannam and the dust that gathers upon a person's feet in the path of jihad, they cannot gather in one place. As in, if you have got the dust that has come onto your feet in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in jihad, then the smoke of Jahannam cannot come on those feet. Forget the fire of Jahannam. These two things, dust in the path of jihad and the smoke of Jahannam, they cannot gather. Wherever one is, the other will not be there. If the ghubar is there, then Jahannam, the smoke of Jahannam will be there. And if the smoke of Jahannam is stretching through there, let me tell you, then the dust that you have gathered in jihad, that will not be there. This is what this woman gathered for herself. She was a woman. Think about it. Imagine how fragile women are. What took her into the baal? Think about it. If it wasn't iman, if it wasn't her desire for Jannah, if it wasn't her desire to stay away from Jahannam, then what was it? It was none other than her iman that she had upon Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Finally, her transmission of ahadith narrations. 5 minutes. Finally, her transmission of ahadith. Does she actually acquire the sawab of even transmitting a hadith of Rasulullah in which there is so much sawab in itself? The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam has actually referred to those people who learn his hadith and who transmit his hadith and send his hadith forward as his representatives. Ki those people who learn my hadith and who learn them word to word and who protect them and who give them to other people, i.e. the muhaddithin, and those people who deal with the hadith, Rasulullah, he said, these people are my representatives. And the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that nazzara Allahu imran, may Allah keep them fresh. May Allah keep them fresh. And look, our ustaz, he says, I've noticed that every guy who teaches hadith, go and touch his hands, you'll see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have given him very, very soft hands because of the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You'll see that until the end of their life, they stay tarotazu. Allah keeps them fresh, very, very fresh, spiritually fresh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps them. Why? Because they have protected the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Remember the hadith of Rasulullah. What is it? These are the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You protecting the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You are a bodyguard of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She was like a bodyguard. She preserved. Even if it's one hadith on the final hajj, what did the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say to sahaba? He said, "Ballighu anni walau ayah." Deliver from me even if it's one ayat. Even if you can tell somebody one ayat, deliver the ayat. Even if it's one ayat, even if it's one hadith, why? The Prophet says in another hadith, he says that there's certain people who have one hadith, but they're not very, very understanding of the hadith. And what do? They give the hadith to another individual. And Allah has given that individual such an understanding that it's one hadith, but he will be able to solve 100 people's problems. These are not the words of the Prophet, these are my own words, but I'm saying that the Prophet Allah says that there's certain people, they don't have much understanding, but they'll have a hadith, they'll have some knowledge. And what do? They give it to a person who has more understanding. What does he mean? As in, you might give it to somebody like Imam Abu Hanifa or Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi, you might give it to somebody like Imam Malik or Imam Ahmad, and they're going to write books and books and books. There's one hadith of Rasulullah in which there's a muhaddith. The Prophet ﷺ, he was walking past a small child. The small child's name was Umair. His name was Umair. And this child, he had a little bird, which was called Nughair. The bird was called Nughair. So Rasulullah ﷺ had a little joke with him. One day he was walking past him. He used to always walk past his child and have a little joke with him. One day that bird died. So he didn't have it in his hand. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, Ya Umair, ma fa'al al-Nughair. Ya Umair, ma fa'al al-Nughair. Oh Umair, what's happened to Nughair? So the boy was crying. Just that much. The Rawi, the narrator, narrates the hadith forward. There's 100 masle that come from that hadith. Just a little sentence. Ya Umair, ma fa'al al-Nughair. There's a full book that is written on that. So even if it's one hadith and you transmit that forward, that is enough to actually reap in all the rewards of being a transmitter of hadith. So later on, I just want to quickly finish off that she... Later on, like I mentioned about Abu Sufyan, she was Abu Sufyan's wife. Abu Sufyan moved from Makkah al-Mukarrama, he went to Madina al-Murawa and he passed there. Similarly, she moved with him and she died before Abu Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Madina al-Munawwara. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give her the mitti. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the mitti and give us tawfiq to die in Madina al-Munawwara. Raise us with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Raise us amongst the ranks of Sahaba radiallahu anhum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from hating, cursing, swearing and abusing Sahaba radiallahu anhum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us true love for Sahaba. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Jazakumullah.